Father, we are humbled to be in your presence, Father, amazed at your faithfulness and love. God, so grateful for who you are and more that you would choose to use us, Father, even though, God, that there's no reason that you should work through people like us, God, broken people, people, Lord, that would fail you through our sinfulness, God, that you are merciful and gracious. And God, use us anyway. And Lord, I just pray, God, that you would bless us, Lord, with your word this morning. And Father, that you would speak to us through your heart. And Holy Spirit, that you would work in us and move in us. And God, that you would propel us forward, Father, in the pursuit of you. And that, God, we would not be complacent, that you would not allow us to be complacent. And God, that even as Brother Mark prayed, Lord, that as a body, Father, it's our desire to work together, to be effective together, and to make much of you, Father, by the way that we love one another and to love the people around us, God, proclaiming your truth. And Lord, we ask, God, that you would begin this morning a movement through these moments that we share, Father, and that this movement would transform our lives. And Lord, we're so grateful for what you do and who you are. So we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So this morning we're going to be in Genesis chapter 16 and verse 1. We're going to look at some people who had a major problem. They had this major problem in their life. We're going to learn from the example that they set, because there's two types of examples, right? There's people that are good examples, and then we get people that are bad examples. And these were people who we would look back at and say, good people who set a bad example. Good people who made a bad decision. Good people who didn't always trust in the direction that God was going. And I can relate to that sometimes. Because no matter how good we think that we try to be, we're still a broken, fallen people. And I struggle sometimes with trusting in the direction that God leads, because there are times that God asks us to do things that aren't very comfortable for us as people. In fact, I have found in my life that the times that God pushes me the hardest, the times that He asks me to get into the situations that I'm not comfortable in, are normally the times when I grow the most as His follower, are normally the times that He does something tangible, amazing in our lives. And so, Genesis chapter 1, or chapter 16, verse 1, Scripture says this: Now Sarai, Abram's wife, bare him no children, and she had a handmaid, an Egyptian, whose name was Hagar. So here, Sarai would become Sarah, and Abram would become Abraham, and Abraham and Sarah had a major issue. Sarah couldn't have children. They didn't have any children. This meant that Abraham didn't have a descendant. This was a big deal in their culture. And for Sarah, this was a shamefulness. She would have been ashamed of the fact that she couldn't have children, and saying that she knew something wrong with her. So from a cultural perspective, this was shameful for Sarah and an embarrassment for Abraham. They had a major issue that they couldn't fix. I don't know if you can relate to that sometimes. Have you ever had a major issue in life? A major problem that you just couldn't fix yourself? You had to depend upon other people. You had to depend upon God to show up in your life. This is where Abraham and Sarah, let's look here. Go back a chapter in Genesis chapter 15, verses 1 through 4. The Bible says this: After these things, the word of the Lord came unto Abram in a vision, saying, Fear not, Abram, I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward. And Abram said, Lord God, what wilt thou give me, seeing I go childless, and the steward of my house, Eliezer of Damascus? And Abram said, Behold, to me thou hast given no seed, and lo, one born in my house is mine heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, This shall not be thine heir, but he that shall come forth out of thine own bowels shall be thine heir. So we only need to back up here one chapter in the Word of God, back to Genesis chapter 15, to find out that God had made a promise to Abraham that he would provide for him an heir. That he would provide for him. We only got to go back one chapter to find out that God had already made this promise that he was going to intervene and fix Abraham's problem. The promise had already been made, and then all that Abraham and Sarah had to do was what? Trust in God's promise. That's all he had to do. All Abraham and Sarah had to do was say, well, we've got a major issue, but God's already made the promise, and I'm going to trust in that promise. It's all he needed to do, and that is simple, isn't it? It seems simple enough until you identify yourself that you're a worrier. That's how I know we're all a little bit of worriers in here. We worry. When's it going to happen? How's it going to work out? And I've prayed, and if you've found yourself in a situation where you have prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed and sought the face of God and prayed that God would intervene in your life, and yet he hasn't shown up and answered the promise or answered your prayers the way that you wanted or in the time you wanted, and as time goes by and as days become weeks and months and years, and that child's still not doing the things that you're praying about, and you're still praying for God to show up and answer some prayers in your finances, and you're still seeking the Lord about the job and what do you want, God, and what direction are you going to do it? And Lord, I've been praying for these people that I care about in my life, and when are you going to show up, God? And when you've prayed for a long time and nothing's happened, it gets difficult to always trust in the promises, doesn't it? See, it's easy for us to look back at Abraham and Sarah and say, well, they failed, when you know the whole story. Because we kind of fast forward through the years, don't we? We turn the pages, and it's quick to us. For them, this was a lifetime. God, when are you going to show up? But God made a promise, but Abraham and Sarah still had a problem. And this is what we're going to talk about this morning, is simply this. I want to talk to you this morning, there's a difference between the promise versus the problem. Because all of us in life are going to have some problems, and God has promised to do some things, and you're going to have to decide this morning what side of the fence you're going to be on. Each of us are going to be faced with making a decision about this at some point. Am I going to trust in God's promises, or am I going to focus on the problem? Am I going to trust that God's going to do what he said he's going to do, or am I going to be consumed with the problems that I have in life? Because our lives can easily become consumed with worry, with desperation, concern, and anxiety over the problems that we have in life. Can be consumed with those things. Yet, we can open up God's Word, can't we? And we find promises in it. I'll never leave thee nor forsake thee. Man, isn't that a great promise? Fantastic promise. No matter what happens in my life, no matter when the world falls down around me, no matter what comes, coming to church this morning, Jerry called me, somebody broke in. And here's what I was driving to church. Here's my prayer. Lord, they can take every computer in the building. Just don't let them take the sound stuff. I don't have to scream all morning. It's just a problem. That's not the end of the world, is it? You know, hey, we can have issues in life. Things can happen. We come in, and CJ and Brandon spent all morning trying to fix some lighting and stuff. And so what are we going to do? I said, we survived that lighting for a long time. We'll be okay. Last week, it was, hey, the air conditioner doesn't work. And we survived. Lost a couple pounds. But we survived, didn't it? Of all the things that we've done, I've never had more people ask me about anything than when did the air conditioner get fixed? Some of you were trying to determine whether you were coming to church this morning. It's funny how we can get so focused and consumed with the problems that we miss out on what it is that God's doing and the promises that he's made to us, because God promises to be with us. God promises to protect us this morning. And God promises, listen, for you as an individual, if you're a child of the King, God promises to take care of you. He promises those things. And yet when issues arise in life and when problems come, we get so focused on the problem that we miss out on the fact that God's already made some promises that I can place my faith and trust in, because I choose to focus on the problem instead of the promise. And I want you to get this morning. In fact, we're going to bring it up, and you can read it here with me, is this: that you will react to what you look at. You can read that with me. We'll read it again. You ready? You will react to what you look at. That's the way that life works. Some of you are so focused on the problem, you're reacting to the problem because you don't have your focus on the promises of God. But if you're focusing on the promise, you don't really react to the problem because you realize some things. It's not your problem. That's the Lord's problem. I'm His child. But you're going to react to what it is that you look at. And you need to change your focus off of the problems and start looking at the promises of God in your life. You need to make sure that your attention is on the right things instead of the wrong things. Why are you so consumed with worry? Because you got your focus on the wrong place, the wrong thing. My wife said something a couple months ago. She said this, she goes, "I realize that you're not my problem." I said, "Praise the Lord." For the first 14 years, apparently, I was a problem. She said, "I realize that now, you're not my problem." She said this, she said, "You're not my responsibility. You're the Lord's responsibility. You're His problem. If you're not doing it," I think sometimes as a spouse we think, well, hey, I gotta do this, I gotta take care of this person, or if they don't do the thing that I think they should do, I'm gonna be ticked off. And as she said, my job and my problem is to love you, to love this family, to support you. My job is to do what I've been called to do. Your job is to do what you've been called to do. And if you don't do what you've been called to do, it doesn't mean that I get to stop doing what I've been called to do. Because you're God's problem. He'll take care of you. I just got to take care of me." They get scary when they tell you that. But isn't that true? Listen, some of you are here, and you're so focused on your spouse that you're thinking, well, if I could fix them, if I could do all that, or they're not who they're supposed to be, so I'm not going to be who I'm supposed to be. Well, then listen, then you're just as much in sin as they are. You just focus on being who you're supposed to be and loving your spouse the way that God's called you to, and hand your spouse over to an almighty, powerful God who can change the hearts of men and women. You see, we got to make sure our focus is on the right place, because we will react to what we look at. I want you to see here in Genesis chapter 16, verses 2-3. "Now Sarai said unto Abram, Behold now, the Lord hath restrained me from bearing." You see, she had her focus on the problem, didn't she? "I can't have kids. I pray thee, go in unto my maid. It may be that I may obtain children by her. And Abram hearkened to the voice of Sarai. And Sarai, Abram's wife, took Hagar, her maid, the Egyptian. And Abram had dwelt 10 years in the land of Canaan, and gave her to her husband, Abram, to be his wife." So because Sarah had her focus on the problem, she reacted, she responded to the problem by trying to do what we try to do, and that's fix her own problem. Listen, it's obvious God's not going to give me a child. This is never going to work out. We've been praying about this. We've asked God to intervene, and He's not done it yet. And I'm getting a little impatient, and we all know we can be a little impatient in life. And she gets impatient. She says, "Listen, I figured out a way to fix our problem. I got this under control now. I want you to have a child with my handmaid. I want you to take her as your wife. And we'll have kids there. And that's how I'm going to fix my problem." This was Sarah's attempt to fix the problem that was consuming her life. And when we allow ourselves to stare at our problems instead of the promises of God, life becomes desperate. We become desperate. I look at this with Sarah and think how heartbreaking is it. That was a stupid decision, rejecting the promises of God. Yet in her desperation, she tries to fix her own problem, or her own problem, and desperation. Listen this morning, your desperation to fix your problem will lead to poor choices.